Hello friends, welcome back to All About Structural Analysis and Design. So 2 days back, I had posted one poll in the community section that who all are interested for the explanation of IS 456-2000. So I have got many positive responses out of the votes which I have received. Around 96% votes had said that they are interested for this IS 456 explanation series. So that's why I have thought that we'll come up with this explanation, and as far as possible with my best knowledge, I will try to give the explanation of this IS 456-2000 on a regular basis. So as and how I get time, so I will be uploading these explanation, brief explanation about IS 456-2000. So, and you can share this video, like this video, and also if you like our content, you can subscribe our channel All About Structural Analysis and Design. So let's start with this today's lecture or brief explanation, the beginning of brief explanation of IS 456-2000. So one thing I want to tell you, I will not make this series a lengthy one. Means this series will be divided into small videos, around 10 to 12 minutes videos, so that you will not get bored about this particular explanation. So I will make it sweet and short. So I will try to cover the things, more things in 10 to 12 minutes. Okay, so let's start with today's video. So this is your IS 456-2000, which is reaffirmed in the year 2005. And this you can get the PDF if you search in the Google search engine as IS 456-2000 download. The first link you will be getting, you can easily download this particular code. So the heading of this IS 456-2000 is Plain and Reinforced Concrete Code of Practice, fourth revision, and it is a 10th reprint, April 2007, which I have got through the net. So you can just download this, and remember the heading of this particular IS 456 is Plain and Reinforced Cement Concrete Code of Practice. So if you scroll down here, there is a contents section. The section 1 is general section, and section 2 starts with the materials, workmanship, inspection and testing. So whatever the knowledge you have in the concrete technology, those knowledge will be given again in brief form in the materials part. So we'll just scroll down to this particular pages, so you will be finding lot many things. As and how we will go through this series, I will be telling you which part we are starting with. So these things are not required today, so we'll just scroll down here and we'll start with the section 1. So this is your section 1, general section. Here they have given scope of the standard. So this standard deals with the general structure, structural use of plain and reinforced concrete. So it gives the standards for the plain as well as reinforced concrete, and also for this for the purpose of the standard, plain concrete structures are those where reinforcement, if provided, is ignored for determination of the strength of the structure. So if you are using plain concrete and you are reinforcing the reinforcement there, so it is ignored for the determination of strength of the structure. Okay, so plain concrete, usually we don't provide a plain concrete structures. So even if you provide reinforcement for plain concrete, if you design, it will be ignored for the determination of the strength of the structure. And 1.2 says a special requirements of structures such as shells, folded plates, arches, bridges, chimneys, blast resistant structures, hydraulic structures, liquid retaining structures and earthquake resistant structures. So these are the special structures which are covered in respective standards. Respective standards in the sense, for all these things, different IS codes are there and have not been covered in this standard. So other than this code, there are different codes for these particular requirements of special structures. So these things have not been covered in the standard, but these standards shall be used in conjunction with this standard. So whatever these codes you are using for these above special structures will be used in with the reference of this particular standard. So this is the main code, you can say, for the RCC design. And the references to produce this particular code code is listed in page number 77 of Annexure A. So you can go to page number 77. There you can find the list of standards which is containing provisions through which reference in this text constitutes provision of this standard. So at the time of publication, the additions indicated were valid. All standards are subject to revisions. Next part is terminology. So whatever terminology you'll be using for purpose of the standard, the definitions given in IS 4845 and IS 6461 part 1 to 12 shall generally apply. So the terminologies which we'll be using here, the definitions are given in IS 4845 and IS 6461. And this is the symbols which we'll be using for this particular code. So all these things are given. So for example, A, capital A means area, B means small b means breadth of beam, or shorter dimension of a rectangular column. So these are the things you have to remember. So whenever you start the RCC design, so you have to go through these symbols so that it will be easy to understand the next particular calculations and what is meant by those symbols. So I recommend you to go through these symbols because it is very difficult to explain each and every symbol in this particular lecture. As and when it is required, I'll be telling you in the next particular pages. Okay, so then again on page number 12 also it is continued. Yeah, so that was with the section 1. Now the section 2 starts. It contains materials, workmanship, inspection and testing. So the fifth point in this particular code is materials, and the first is cement. The cement shall be any of the following, and type selected should be appropriate for the intended use. So for the use which you are using for any structure, so it shall appropriately be used. So that is 33 grade, 43 grade, 53 grade, rapid hardening Portland cement conforming to IS 8041, then Portland slag cement conforming to IS 455, Portland pozzolana cement. Again, for each of these particular cements, different codes they have mentioned. So if you want to know the other things of that particular cement, you have to go to these particular IS codes and you have to refer that one. Okay, so other combinations of Portland cement with mineral admixtures, C5.2 they have told, because 5.2 is entirely for mineral admixture. So you have to go to that particular paragraph of quality conforming with the relevant Indian standards laid down. Okay, so for the combinations of Portland cement with mineral admixtures, you have to go to 5.2. Okay, so low heat Portland cement conforming to IS 12600 shall be used with adequate precautions with regard to of removal of formwork, etc. So these are the precautions you have to comply with. Then high alumina cement conforming to IS 6452, or super sulfonated cement conforming to IS 6909, may be used only under special circumstances with the prior approval of the engineer in charge. So if you are going for high alumina cement and all, so the appropriate suggestions you have to take from the engineer who is in charge, and a specialist literature, may be consultant for guidance regarding the use of this cement. So these care you have to take whenever you are going for high alumina cement. Then the attention of the engineers in charge and users of cement is drawn to the fact that quality of various cements mentioned in 5.1. So whatever the quality is which is mentioned in 5.1 here in their particular respective codes, on the basis of its conformity of the performance characteristic given in respective standard. So you have to take care of that particular respective standard and you have to do it. So next is 5.2. It says about mineral admixtures, the pozzolans. So the pozzolanic materials conforming to relevant Indian standards may be used with the permission of engineer in charge. Okay, so you have to take the permission of the engineer in charge of that particular project, and provided uniform blending with cement is ensured. Okay, but nowadays the mineral admixtures are coming with the directly cement bag from the company itself. So nowadays it is very easy to use this pozzolanic cement. Then fly ash, pulverized fuel ash, you have to confirm with the grade 1 of IS 3812. Okay, maybe used as a part replacement of OPC. Okay, provided uniform blending with cement is ensured. So you can use replacement for OPC, not complete, but part replacement. Some part you can replace provided uniform blending should be used. Then silica fume, again conforming to standard approved by the deciding authority, may be used as part replacement. Anywhere they have not mentioned complete replacement, so only part replacement of cement, provided again uniform blending of cement is ensured. Okay, then this small note they have given, the silica fume, very fine non-crystalline silicon dioxide, is a byproduct of the manufacture of silicon, ferrosilicon, or the like from quartz and carbon in electric arc furnace. It is usually used in the proportion of 5 to 10% of the cement content of a mix. So again, they have given one small note that only 5 to 10% of the cement content of this proportion is used for make a mix. Then again, rice husk ash, they have said that required performance and uniformity characteristics may be used with the approval of the deciding authority. So the deciding authority will decide whether to use the particular pozzolanic materials or no. Then one more is metakaolin. Metakaolin having fineness between 700 to 900 meter square kg may be used as pozzolanic material in concrete. And the metakaolin is obtained by calcination of pure or refined kaolinitic clay at a temperature between 650 degrees and 850 degrees following the grinding to achieve a fineness of 700 to 900 meter square per kg. The resulting material has high pozzolanicity. Okay, so metakaolin, which is having the fineness, okay, you might have done fineness of cement in your material testing lab, so I assume that everyone knows what is fineness. So it should be between 700 to 900 meter square per kg. Okay, and that may be used as a pozzolanic material in concrete. Then one more type of pozzolanic material is ground granulated blast furnace slag. The ground granulated blast furnace slag obtained by again grinding granulated blast furnace slag conforming to, again you have to refer the code IS 12089, and may be used as part replacement of ordinary Portland cements, provided again uniform blending with cement is ensured. So if you go through again complete 5.2, so it says you have to use it as part replacement provided the sanctioning authority is going for this particular pozzolanic material addition. And you have to remember that only part replacement is approved and not complete replacement to cement. So this is how we will end this particular today's explanation here. Okay, so next video will be on the aggregates, and hence it will be continued in the next coming series. Okay, so you can comment in the comment section about the review of this particular kind of video. Your comments are welcomed, and we will try to make as easy as possible the explanation of IS 456-2000. Thank you, friends.